And now, we talked about point of inquiry, about For Good Reason, a podcast produced in association with the James Randi Educational Foundation. Now we move to another prominent podcast, really probably the leading podcast in the skeptical world, with 120,000 downloads in the last, what did you tell me, the last month, is that right? On average in a month. And I'm going to introduce to you, to who will in turn introduce the rest of our guests in this next part of the program, Dr. Steve Novella. He is an academic clinical neurologist at the Yale University School of Medicine. He created the Neurological Blog, which covers news and issues in neuroscience, but also general science, scientific thinking, critical thinking, philosophy of science, and other related subjects like that. He contributes regularly to the Rogues Gallery, which is the blog of the SGU, to the Skeptic blog, and of course to science-based medicine, which is an area of his particular focus and expertise. And so he is also the creator of this extraordinarily popular and appropriately so skeptical podcast. And so right now, you will get to enjoy for the next while a very special broadcast of the podcast which he created, which is the SGU, or the Skeptical Guide to the Universe, which is produced in association with the James Randi Educational Foundation. Please welcome Dr. Steve Novella. Steve.
Hello and welcome to the Skeptic's Guide to the Universe. Today is Saturday, April 17th, 2010, and this is your host, as you just heard, Stephen Novella. And we are live from NECSS 2010. Joining me this week, as always, is our own amateur physicist, the man with the nano plan, Bob Novella. Next, we have the original skeptic herself, the queen of snark, and Mrs. Sid Rodriguez, Rebecca Watson. As well, we have our own wannabe comedian, the man who's always free with the non sequitur and making fun of some strange accent, Jay Novella. And joining us, as always, is the guy who is almost too nice for his own good, and also the Popeye of the SGU. I'm always making the funny quips in the background that you have to listen carefully to hear. Evan Bernstein. And we have a special guest for this SGU live show, James Randi. As always, at these events, we like to remember our lost rogue, Perry DeAngelis. The annual memorial SGU shows were happening in the fall, but we're going to be shifting them to the spring with NECSSS, as this is our regional live show. And I don't know, most of you probably were listening to the show back when Perry was on. We still get emails. you know, on a regular basis from people who are listening back through our archives and are losing Perry for the first time. And it still is incredible to us how much he can really emotionally affect, you know, people who are listening to him, you know, over the SGU, over the podcast. And for them, the loss is still fresh, and they feel compelled to write to us. And in a little way, you know, it touches us, but we sort of lose Perry all over again every time that happens. But it still keeps him fresh in our mind. And of course, you know, his name comes up frequently on our show because his the kind of person that he was, and you know, which touched all of us, still lives on in the show through all of us. So we take this moment to remember the great Perry DeAngelis. Evan, what is that plume of smoke behind me?
Wow. That's a heck of a plume, isn't it? That is a volcanic eruption. The one in Iceland we've all been hearing about the last several days, unless you've been in a cave somewhere, or trapped in Europe. So what we have here is a glacier in Iceland, pronounced Eyvindarlaxvits. It took me a long time to...
Say that again, Evan.
Eyvindarlaxvits.
Leivitz?
Leivitz, Leivin.
With the Leivitz.
This is that's the name of the glacier that covers the volcano in Iceland. And it went up. It actually went up last month initially. There was an initial explosion in March, but on April 14th, it really blew its top, about 20 times more powerful than the explosion that happened in March. And it is causing some pretty big havoc over Europe. Air traffic, as far as I know today, is still shut down in just about all of Europe. And you know, it's quite an event. There's not been something this restrictive on air travel since the events of September 11th, 2001.
Yeah, certainly this is the biggest European flight shutdown ever.
Ever.
Perfect timing. Yeah. A volcano.
This volcano has erupted before in history, back in 920 AD. 1612 and in 1821. So this is an active volcano that does, you know, bear fruit quite regularly, and we are feeling those effects right now.
So why are we talking about this volcano, Evan?
Well, we're talking about the volcano. Well, because it is big news, because it is a topic of science, and because it has, well, affected us at the SGU, in a sense.
Right. So you all know that Rebecca moved to London. For some reason, she thought it would be a good idea to live with her husband.
Yes, I did.
Yeah. And all the London airports were shut down. They're still shut down. So how did you get here?
Magic.
Was it this you rode some unicorns across a rainbow or something?
I was actually just waiting for you to stop talking so I could say, I rode a unicorn.
Okay. Yeah. Perfect. You're not as tall as last time. Are they not feeding you over in London?
No. I've lost a little bit of weight. And
you don't like
I'm
the
not
bangers?
Feeling very good. No.
Not into the bangers, huh?
I went blonde.
Yeah.
Sid likes blondes.
I get it.
That was a little awkward. Okay, so we actually have audio of Rebecca, so let's let Rebecca say hi.
Hi.
So you're faux Becca. Rebecca is.
Be there, but I hope you all have a good time, and I hope.
No, that was it.
That was
it.
What
do you think? This is Rebecca Watson. I'm sorry that I couldn't be there, but there was a volcano, and my plane couldn't take off, and it was exactly like in 2012, only instead of John Cusack, it was me. And instead of Yellowstone National Park, it was Iceland. And instead of billions of people dying, it was a slight inconvenience for me. So I can see how those two things relate and how this is much, much worse. So I'm so sorry I can't be there, but I hope you all have a good time. And I hope to see you all at the next live show we do.
Good enough. That's enough.
That's about it.
I noticed she didn't commit to what live show that would be. Ooh. Just the next one, whatever. Next one I guess she could make it to. But for those of you who may not have noticed at this point, that sitting to my left is actually the new head of the Boston Skeptics, right?
Yes.
Yes, Liz Gaston. Liz, welcome.
Hi.
She's wearing Rebecca's hat and coat, which she had intended to return to Rebecca today.
No, I didn't.
Oh.
I'm keeping these.
That she stole from Rebecca. So we figured that nobody would notice. You know, we brought her out wearing Rebecca's hat and coat.
And squatchy.
And squatchy, right. That was good camouflage. So how are things going up at Boston Skeptics?
They're pretty fun. It's been really cool getting to be more involved with it. And I have to say, though, I'm not really the head. I'm like part of the head group. So they have to give credit to all my friends who do a lot more work than I do. But I'm the host of Boston Skeptics in the Pub. And I just wanted to let you guys know, while I have the microphone, that coming up pretty soon, I think like in a week or a week and a half or something, I have no idea, we have Amanda Marcotte coming to the Brattle Theater. We're having our Skeptics in the Pub at a theater, but they do have beer, so it's okay. And she'll be doing, I guess, a book signing and talking about her new book, which I believe is called Get Opinionated. Someone out there might know better than I do, but she's pretty cool, though, so we're really excited about that. And if you'd like some more information about that, you can just go to bostonskeptics.com. We have other events around Boston, too. Like, we have a book club, we have brunches, so, yeah, we have a lot of cool stuff going on.
Thank you. That was perfect imitation of Rebecca, who always managed to plug a local Boston event,
yes,
even when we have a podcast that goes out to all seven continents.
Yes. Right.
Steve, Liz is also representing Sid here, so flip your name tag, please.
Because you can read this, right? Yeah.
Go ahead.
Hello, Governor.
Sid. Jay made her do that.
Yeah, that was Jay's fault.
I told you about him, an accent, I'm telling you. All right. What does that picture remind you of?
Ark of the Covenant.
Ark of the Covenant? It's supposed to be a life after death kind of thing, a near-death experience. Anybody in the room ever have a near-death experience? You know, actually not a lot. What did you say? Not a lot of people know this, but Perry actually had a near-death experience. Unfortunately, he died right after that. So we never got to hear what it was.
You really went there, Steve.
It's too soon?
No, we can make fun. All right.
No, Perry would love that.
There was one of the times that Perry was hospitalized, he actually did have like a lack of oxygen experience where he thought he was being abducted by aliens.
Yes, that's correct.
Which is similar, right?
Well,
not really.
It was a brain experience, so it's similar in that way. Yep. And the way he told this story was that when he first snapped back to reality was when he saw my daughter Julia, who was like 2 at the time or 18 months, and that he knew that she couldn't be part of some alien conspiracy to abduct him. So that brought him back to reality. No, but there near-death experiences are one of those topics that we've discussed previously. That is an experience that people have when they are getting cardiopulmonary resuscitation, their heart stops, they're unconscious, they're getting just enough oxygen to the brain to keep it from dying, but not enough to be conscious. And then when they wake up from this experience, which may be a day or two later, some people will report seeing a light or a doorway, maybe even seeing, passing through a tunnel, maybe seeing people that they know that have already died, and feeling as if they're floating outside their body, usually above their body. They often may actually even report that they can look down and see their body beneath them. And then when the case reports get interesting, some people report actually some of the details of like which nurses were attending to them while they were getting CPR. Now, of course, there's almost a cottage industry of book writers and others who are promoting this as evidence for the afterlife. But, you know, skeptical neuroscientists like myself and others point out that these experiences are remarkably similar to what happens to the brain when it is deprived of oxygen. And in fact, we could induce all the components of that experience, floating outside one's body, for example, with either medications. Now we can do it by using transcranial magnetic stimulation to turn off parts of the brain. I've had patients who have had that experience while having a seizure. So there's a lot of evidence sort of triangulating on the fact that this is probably a brain experience, not any kind of dualistic mind separate from body experience.
Steve, do I think I remember reading, they said that people in the Dark Ages actually had different like experiences, like the similar experience, but like the idea that was playing in their head was different. Like today people see like a stairway or visitations from dead relatives, but back then didn't they see like more horrifying details?
Culturally relevant?
Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, I think that phenomenon is more relevant to the like alien abduction hypnagogia, where in the Middle Ages people saw demons and angels, now they see aliens. Right, so same exact experience, just replace the demon with an alien. So that's very culturally specific. With near-death experiences, they do sort of fit in around the edges, culturally specific experiences. So Christians have a Christian near-death experience, basically.
Steve, I must say that I had an automobile accident when I was 17 years of age in Toronto, Canada. I was struck by a car, had a spinal injury, and I woke up in the hospital having already gone down a tunnel with a light at the end of it. The typical classical experience that people relate. So I've had the experience myself, therefore I can relate very, very closely to it. It's very realistic and interesting too. I made notes.
Mm-hmm. Steve, isn't the tunnel itself a neurological phenomenon based on the structure of the brain, not something that you can filter through your culture, but something that's actually because of the way the brain is structured.
Yeah.
That's why you see what appears to be a tunnel.
So that's one of the common cross-cultural elements is the tunnel vision floating outside the body. The real hardcore neurological stuff is cross-cultural. But then, you know, seeing an angel or something more cultural gets filled in. You know, the details get sort of retrofitted into this experience, basically. So the new news item, the reason why we're talking about this, putting this in context, is a new study that was published where they essentially they looked at a series of people who had cardiac arrest and were resuscitated. They had cardiac arrest outside the hospital and then were brought in and resuscitated in the emergency room. And you know, typically about 10 to 15% of people who undergo that will have a near-death experience. The other 85% or so do not. It's not really clear why that is. And whenever you have two groups like that, you can ask questions. What's different about the two groups? And that's what they did. They looked at a host of metabolic parameters. And what they found is the only thing that correlated with having a near-death experience was increased carbon dioxide levels in the blood. Nothing else correlated with it, not the duration, not the oxygen. And one of the leading, actually their leading hypothesis going in was that it was medication, that the people who were getting narcotics and other drugs surrounding the event, that maybe they were producing the experience, because we know drugs can produce similar experiences. But that didn't correlate, whereas the CO2 very highly predicted who would go on, who had a near-death experience and who didn't. Now, this is an observational study, right? Obviously, it's not blinded in any way. It's not experimental. You can't, you know, make people have a cardiac arrest and randomize them, you know. So we have to be satisfied with them, right? No, we have to be satisfied with these kind of observational studies, so you never know what the cause and effect is, right? That's the thing. You don't know, we have no idea. First of all, is the correlation real or is it spurious? Needs to be replicated. If it's real, where's the arrow of cause and effect? Is the high CO2 causing the brain to have this experience for certain modules in the brain to shut down to make you feel like you're floating outside your body, for example? Or is the high CO2 just a marker of something else, which is really the thing that's causing these experiences? So this is, again, very preliminary evidence. We can't really make any conclusions from it. Now, the major problem I have with this study, actually, those are just generic weaknesses of this kind of study. The major problem I have with it is the premise that the people who are having the experiences are having them while they're undergoing CPR, because that's when they measure the oxygen, the carbon dioxide and everything else. That's when their CO2 levels were elevated. But what if the experience that they're having is occurring an hour later or a day later while their brains are slowly recovering from the experience? Then by the time they become conscious, they conflate all those memories. They have no time sense. To them, it just happened, right? And just happened, so it must have happened while they were getting CPR. they were floating outside their body. But they could have incorporated memories from the last 2 days when they were delirious, when their brain was slowly recovering.
Why would their sense of time change? Because I think when I sleep, I have a sense of time.
Yeah, but have you ever had full general anesthesia?
Yeah.
Was there any passage of time?
I don't remember.
No. Yeah, right.
Success.
Yeah, I mean, probably a lot of people here have had the kind of general anesthesia where you're going 99, 98, 97, and then bingo, you're in the recovery room. There was no passage of time, right? I mean, if the mind were separate from the brain, I don't think that's what you would experience, right? Wouldn't you have some experience for the 2 hours or whatever? But when your brain is off, there is literally zero appreciation for the passage of time.
What about dualism?
Right.
I'm agreeing with you.
I know.
Oh, yeah, Steve, you mentioned the counting backwards thing. I remember a stint from the Honeymooners many years ago with Art Carney and Jackie Gleason, the late greats. I mean, it was just wonderful. Jackie Gleason is in the bed, and they've given him sodium pentothal, and the doctor says to him, count back from 100, and Art Carney says, why? He says, oh, because when he stops counting, we'll know that he's under the effect of the narcotic. Oh, okay. So Gleason says, oh, all right, 100, 99, 98, 4. And his head dropped to the side.
Right.
But, you know, this business also, I must recount to you, if I may, for a moment. When I was recovering from this trauma of hitting my back rather strongly in an automobile accident, I remember that I saw the tunnel with the light at the end of it, and there was a rumbling sort of a thing, and I didn't know what that was all about. And it turns out that I was on a gurney or a stretcher, whatever, in the hospital being taken down a hall, and I was seeing these lights traveling above me from the ceiling, and I was trying to say, I'm alive, and so they wouldn't put me into the box, you see. And I remember that I combined two experiences here.
I'm getting better.
The person at the end of the tunnel was the ambulance attendant who looked down and said, no, I don't think he's going to make it. And I was saying, I'm alive. But
did
I combined
you make it?
The experiences. I made it.
Okay, good.
Just in case you're wondering. Right. Very interesting what happens in the head, though. As we were talking earlier backstage, Steve and I were speaking. Tell us that story, Randy. Sorry?
Tell him that story. It's a good, if you mind.
Which one?
You just told me backstage.
Oh, I told you so many stories, though, Steve.
The one of the snapping into place.
Oh yeah. Oh no. This is right along Steve's line, of course, and I shared this with him. I'm recovering, as I'm sure you know, from chemotherapy, and recovering very well. Thank you. There you go. And on my second last chemo treatment, the usual procedure was that Brandon Thorpe, my faithful assistant, there would drive me to the hospital, to the infusion ward. Oh, that's a dreadful title to see on the door. And that's where they were going to give me the bag of goodies in my pocket and whatnot to be infused for a couple of days with this dreadful poison. They poison you almost to the point of death, and then they draw you back a little bit, you see, every time. And I survived, as you see. But on my second last visit, I had Brandon drive me over to the hospital, just 2 blocks away from the foundation, and I knew that my cell phone would not work inside the building, shielding on the walls, you see, as in this building itself. And so I would call Brandon when I came out of the infusion, and I would walk over to the parking lot. Now, Brandon was driving a rattletrap, still is, rattletrap white car, and with loose parts on it and everything. It's quite dramatic to see it moving, I can assure you. And I walked down towards the parking lot. Now, there's a media parking section there with 5 spaces just for the media, and you have to have a permit inside your windshield or you can't park there, you see. Well, Brandon happens to have a media pass, so he could wait for me there. So I walked down to the parking lot, and I saw his car come in, and he pulled into place in the media section. And he got out of the car, and he started towards me. And I waved at him like this, but he didn't react. And I thought, well, he just didn't notice me. He was on the cell phone, perhaps. I don't know. But as I got closer to him, I walked up to him, saw him very plainly. And then suddenly, like Photoshop. It wasn't Brandon. It was a totally different guy, taller, with black hair, totally unlike Brandon altogether. That wasn't Brandon, because at that moment, Brandon came around at the corner in another car, his mother's car in this case, his was out of order, the rattletrap one I told you about. And he drove up and went into his parking space in the media, and he got out, and it was Brandon this time. But I had hallucinated completely the presence of Brandon Thorpe coming out of the car and walking towards me and not acknowledging my hand wave like this, and suddenly he came around. This is an astonishing thing, but that's what the brain will do. And as I said to Steve at the time, most people have the illusion that their sensory impression of an event, of the world around them, always represents reality. Not necessarily, folks, and it may happen to you in the difficulties of chemotherapy or some other narcotic of any kind, but with me it has happened. Now, I'm an illusionist. I specialize in producing these illusions for people. For entertainment purposes, I add, always. The point is, I, as a magician, experienced this wonderful transformation, and I told Steve about it, so remember, it ain't always the way it looks.
Right. People always say, I saw it with my own eyes. You know, seeing is believing, but...
With my own eyes. I like that expression. Right. Who else's eyes would they see it with?
But similar to the near-death experiences, these are all brain experiences by necessity, and there's lots of ways in which the brain can go wrong. One is, as Randy described, it tries to sort what it thinks it's seeing into a slot of something it knows. And then the details match what you think you're seeing. And the illusion is completely convincing until, of course, it breaks. And then you have that moment of disorientation when something becomes something else.
And Steve, Randy's example is more of expectation. He was expecting what he expected changed how he interpreted what he saw.
All the parameters were there of the white car coming in. Not Brandon's car, but it looked enough to like it that I was fooled by it. And the guy got out, and it was Brandon. I swear it was Brandon. Right. For the first six or eight steps that he took, and then... snap, right. Just like
and
that.
And if you were taken away, say you left at that point, not having snapped into what it was, you would have testified in a court of law that was Brandon. I saw it with my own eyes, right?
Yes, and I wouldn't be lying. I would be telling them what my sensory impression of it was, and I would be wrong.
Right, very core skeptical principle.
So who can we trust?
that's why
science,
right?
Science.
Science objectifies information. All right. Ooh, pretty. Bob, you're going to tell us why we're looking at that.
Yeah. Did you guys hear about the latest breakthrough in lens technology?
Lens technology.
This is related. This is related to that. Yeah. Our research is at the...
Not me.
Nice.
Guilty.
Thank you, Bob.
We ready now?
Moving on.
All right, I'll text later. Researchers at Graduate Aerospace Laboratories and our buddies at Caltech, I love those guys, they created a breakthrough in lens technology recently using metamaterials to focus and amplify acoustic energy. It's a really interesting advance that they made. Now, they use metamaterials. You guys have heard of metamaterials. We've talked about this in the past a lot. Scientists have used metamaterials to influence and manipulate electromagnetic radiation. It's like an engineered structure that you really can't find in nature that does bizarre things to waves. So you've heard of they always say, oh, look, it's a Harry Potter invisibility cloak. And they're kind of getting there. They can bend x-rays around objects, and they're doing some incredible things. But that metamaterial is for electromagnetism. But you could also use metamaterials to influence things like seismic waves. I saw a plan for a building. They're thinking about constructing a building, and they're putting these seismic metamaterials around the building such that when seismic waves are coming at it, it just kind of bends around the building. So that's another potential application.
Why wouldn't they just turn it, take that energy, turn it into heat energy or something like that?
Turn it into electricity?
First, you can't predict where it's going to come from, so you build it and you wait 2 centuries for an earthquake to come.
Not a reliable energy source?
No, not reliable.
Bob, what are the metamaterials made
out of? So, Jay, for 2 minutes, you got a lot of energy, but then what are you going to do? So not a good idea.
But then you need good batteries to store it. Don't get us started on batteries. Yeah.
What are the materials made out of?
The
metamaterials. Like, I don't even know what those are.
The one I'm going to talk about, you can also use metamaterials to manipulate sound energy. And this is what these guys have used. They can basically take this energy. And when I first saw this device, it didn't make sense to me. It didn't look like a conventional metamaterial. But they actually were inspired by what you're seeing here, Newton's cradle. Everybody's seen this little toy. It's been on probably a million desks for 30 or 40 years. But, you know, you just take one ball and swing it against the other. And it's a great example of conservation of momentum, conservation of energy, friction, how pendulums work. It's a great little instructive device.
Bob, what are the metamaterials made out of?
Next picture, Steve. 411 spheres, metal spheres, stacked into an array of 21 rows, 21 balls by 21 rows. You happy now, Jay?
But you're saying metamaterial. Like, are we talking ball bearings made out of steel?
Pretty much. See, because
so
when
why
you're
dealing, are they metamaterials?
Because you're influencing and manipulating waves. So that's kind of like the hallmark of a metamaterial.
I was thinking more of like nano.
Pay attention,
stuff.
Jay. No, you're thinking of the electromagnetic metamaterials are really tiny because you're dealing with wavelengths of light. So because acoustic energy has a bigger wavelength, it's more macro scale. Okay.
So they're not nano. I'm disappointed.
No, they're not nano. Sorry, not everything I talk about has got to be nano, all right?
All right, but they're meta. At least they're not meta, if not nano.
But yeah.
All right.
Right, meta. Meta's
all right,
good.
That's good enough.
So what these guys do is they see all these spheres here. They're manipulating the pressures, the balls, the spheres against each other. Some of them are pressing hard. Some of them are not pressing so hard. So they manipulate how these balls are kind of squeezing against each other. And the result, it has three basic effects. They go to the back end of the thing and they introduce energy. I think in this case, it's kind of like just a kinetic energy. They just bang the back of it in some way with some device. And because of the way the spheres are packed, three things happen. The energy propagates through, not as motion like Newton's cradle, but it propagates through as like a shock wave. So you got the shock wave going from row to row to row. And apparently, because these chains are so long, they call these rows of spheres chains. These chains are so long that the energy, it doesn't bounce back and reverberate back and forth like Newton's cradle. It exits the apparatus and focuses it at a distance. However, you know, you could focus it far away or nearby, depending on how you arrange the spheres.
Bob, is it powered, or is it just using the energy that's input into it?
Yeah, it's just using the energy and focusing it and amplifying it. It's amplifying it 100 times more than any other similar device. Somebody came up with a really interesting analogy. They said that if you could somehow modify this to accept like an audible input instead of just a kinetic bang, they said that you could go up to it and speak a normal sentence like I'm speaking right now, and it would be able to convert that into a focused energy that could rupture your eardrum. So that's kind of one example.
And that sounds vaguely familiar.
Yeah, it does. I was going to ask the audience, in the world of sci-fi, what does this remind everybody of?
Muad'Dib.
So in Dune, in the...
Muad'Dib.
In
My
the Dune
name
movie,
is a killing word.
In the Dune movie, not the books, but the movie, they went with the idea of using this weirding module, which can take audible sound and turn it into a devastating, you know, attacks of sound energy. And it just made me reminded of that. But real,
that thing's
real
too big to wear on your neck, though, you know?
Yeah, just kind of geeky. But one potential application, if you want real world, you know, real applications for this. Medically, they're talking about using these sound waves to fry tumors. So you could actually target a tumor underneath the skin with this potentially. And because the pressure wave is so intense, the heat is really high. So it could just fry a tumor and leave surrounding tissue unharmed. Supposedly, this is a possibility. Another option is high resolution imaging. We've all seen ultrasounds, but with this device, you could create near photographic quality ultrasound images. So non-invasive imaging, no radiation, so it could be pretty interesting.
Can you break up gallstones with it?
You could do well. The military is going to get their toys out of this too, of course, as well, because you know because you're focusing the sound can go through anything. It can go through water, it can go through rock, because it doesn't really do anything until it actually converges to the point. So people are talking about using this idea to melt submarines underwater as a possibility.
Bob, wait a second. So this you put the sound energy in the back of the machine, and it shoots out this super focused nodule of the way. Hold on. It shoots out this super focused thing, right?
Right.
And if you said it goes through, it can go through rock or go through other materials, why doesn't it just hit the material and do its damage?
Because
there?
The energy isn't focused until it reaches the focal point, right? The destination. That's when it's going to have all the energy.
Oh, so you can kind of like, you can manipulate it so you could say, okay, I want this machine to focus it 20
exactly.
feet deep.
So the way you arrange those spheres will determine how far away it is. And so the military could potentially use this. Also, they could use it for subterranean caves. You get Bin Laden in the cave, and conventional weapons can't affect, because of where he is, if conventional weapons don't work, this thing could potentially just do some devastating
damage. Well, as long
damage.
As we could use it to kill people, I mean, that's what...
Yeah.
Bob.
What?
Kill, cure, doesn't matter.
All right, Bob's new technology disclaimer. I am legally obligated to say this new technology is under development. It may take years and years to be perfected. On the other hand, you will likely never hear about this again. please use as directed, batteries not included. Okay, that's it.
That's from the legal department.
I must say, the fiend that I am, I would like to get one of those ball bearings out of there and secretly substitute a magnetized one. That would mess the whole thing up. The wave function would be broken completely. The pattern
It'd
would
blow
be
up.
Destroyed.
It'd probably just blow up. That'd be cool.
You're such a rascal, Randi.
Yes, I am a rascal. There's no question.
All right. Well, I don't know how many people are aware of this, but we are at the end of the World Homeopathy Awareness Week.
Oh.
Were you guys aware of that?
We missed it.
Randi, you did a YouTube video to commemorate this.
Yes, I did. As a matter of fact, I did a bit on video that maybe some of you have seen here, where I wanted to make sure that we were aware of homeopathy. Homeopathy awareness didn't set out to do what I injected into the movement, but I made people a little more aware of what homeopathy is really all about. It's nothing diluted down with more of this. But I think I handled it in a short video. I handled it rather effectively there, and I got a lot of good reaction from it.
Yeah, I mean, I think the interesting thing is we all want people to be aware of homeopathy,
oh,
too.
Yes.
But, you know, David Gorski, who's sitting in the audience, will be on a panel later, did a couple of great entries on science-based medicine saying, yeah, we want to make people aware that it's total bunk, that there's nothing in homeopathic remedies, that the law of similars and the law of infinitesimals are just magic, and that people who actually rely upon homeopathy for any serious or non-limiting illness actually are harmed by it. But to our commemoration, we are going to show you a little video that Jay put together. This is of a prominent, I don't know if he's really prominent.
He's prominent, yeah.
Of a homeopath, a sort of self-made homeopath who's trying to come to prominence through YouTube and decided that, well, you take a look.
Yeah, turn up the volume on this, guys. I don't think they're getting the audio. You guys hear it?
No.
All right, hold on. Let's let the booth turn up the audio.
You don't want to miss one precious word of this.
Are you guys getting the audio up there?
No.
Wait, hold on. Hey, in the booth? You guys getting the audio?
Let me mic it.
Where's the output?
Where's the output?
Right here.
That's a good idea.
Technical boo-boo.
I can't
Well, you have a quick trick you could do, Randi?
Maybe we're on the wrong one.
I know one, folks. Here we go. Ready? Here you go. There you are. Thank you. I'm out of tricks now.
Let's try it again.
Fella, you don't want to mess with me. There's a lot of intelligent, hardworking people out there who are trying to serve others and make the world a better place. And then there are the flaming hypocrites who try to stop them. People like James the Amazing Randi, Richard Adams, Stephen Novella, Michael Shermer, Edzard Ernst, Harriet Hall, Simon Singh, who, by the way, is getting sued for libel.
He just won.
The opponents of homeopathy, and why it should have any, is becoming more and more of a mystery. are saying that homeopathy is not evidence-based medicine, when in fact, that's all there is. These people I've named form a little community of interest whose purpose is to destroy legal medical practice. It stands alone. The opponents of homeopathy speak as if we, the users, didn't know how it was made. I mean, how many times do you think Randi has been sued? Aren't you curious as to why so many people are using this medicine? How can you just go on continuing to dismiss it? There has been no theory for homeopathy. There is only evidence. Their action is like a bunch of terrorists spreading lies and trying to discourage anyone who wants to get legal medical treatment. And organized skepticism has become its lynch mob. Their action is like a bunch of terrorists spreading lies and trying to discourage anyone who wants to get legal medical treatment. Next time you see one of these jokers at one of their little phony lectures, why don't you just stand up and challenge them with the facts?
Does anybody want to challenge us with any homeopathy facts?
What was that wind blowing in the background? Was that something we did, or did he do all that?
So in the color video that he had, I did put it in here, but if you watch it again at home, you see at one point he's talking, and he does like the drunk burp. He goes... So homeboy's hitting the bottle.
This is also our Name That Logical Fallacy segment of the show. So I hope you were paying attention. There will be a quiz later. So we were intrigued by Mr. Bennett's opinions. So we decided to get some more information, and Jay, our investigative reporter, called him, and we happened, my hand slipped, I hit the record button, you know.
Hold on, guys, for real, do not distribute this. Legally, I don't know how legal this is. Let it just be for us today.
Listen, JJ, it's perfectly legal to record a conversation as long as one person knows they're being recorded. And we're just using this. I'm just going to share this privately with a couple of 100 friends. Right? Just between friends.
I think we better get the Feldmans out here to advise us.
Steve, if you accidentally recorded it, then Jay didn't know and neither did Bennett.
No,
so
Jay,
nobody...
Jay, I told Jay.
Yeah. You told Jay.
And one more thing. Right. We the way Steve edited it, we had 20 minutes of audio. We reduced it down to 6 minutes. But there's a lot of time with him talking. You got to pay attention because he really does say some crazy stuff. And that's why it's heavy on him talking and not on me.
All right, well, let's see what he has to say.
Hello?
Hi, could I talk to John, please?
It's me.
John, hi. I saw you on YouTube, on the internet, and I love the work that you do.
Well, thank you very much. I don't get a lot of compliments. I usually get hate mail.
Oh, boy. Well, I know that, too. I love YouTube. And I had a question for you. I'm very interested in homeopathy. Not those damn doctors. Can you cure cancer?
That's a loaded question. And I can't tell you that. I can't tell you that I can cure cancer. I can't tell you that.
What could we do with homeopathy, though? I'm reading about it, and I don't get it. I don't really understand it that well.
Yeah.
But
yeah.
I'm very curious, like a lot of people I talk to.
In homeopathy, we don't specifically treat any disease. We treat the individual and the individual's own defense system, usually, is what cures the disease. Your immune system is the most powerful form of medicine that we know of. And
right.
So homeopathy is not an intervention like regular medicine is, like chemotherapy or radiation. Those are interventions. Homeopathy is an influence. So it influences your immune system to work on that. I wish I could tell you we cure cancer, but I legally can't do that.
Yeah, well, I can understand.
I do have cancer cases that I am working on. In fact, I was just working on one last night. I have breast cancer cases and this one with the melanoma case. So
What do you do with them?
Well, it depends on the individual. It depends on really what the symptoms are. And we take more than just the cancer symptoms. We take the totality of symptoms. So it requires about an hour of time in order to get that down. And then we repertorize it.
What's that?
Well, we take a cross-index of the symptoms that are associated with a particular remedy. There are about 3,000 different remedies. Now, Hahnemann started out with about 30, but this has grown into quite a large, complex pharmacopoeia or pharmacy.
Yeah.
And the way that these remedies have been proven is through the symptoms that they are associated with. So they would often get the clues as to, we've gotten the clues as to how these remedies work on people by simply giving them to people who are well and then noticing the symptoms that they have with that. And
what's with these fellas? What's with this Randi fella? I don't know why they don't believe you. You're obviously educated. I don't get...
I get a lot of the other kind of people say I'm uneducated or I don't know what I'm talking about.
Well, I saw that too, but you know, look, everybody's got something to say. And who are these people? Who are these guys?
Well, it's funny you mentioned that, because I was just writing an essay on the pathology of these people. And homeopathy, we see various pathologies in people, and there's a particular pathology that is evolving out of all of this that we're seeing. It's really interesting.
What do you mean?
These guys all tend to be atheists.
Yeah.
So, you know, that doesn't make sense at first. And you'd say, well, why should people who are the outspoken opponents of homeopathy or this one particular medical doctrine all be atheists? And as we're looking, in fact, I was just reading on this, as we look deeper into this, we can see that it really comes from a feeling of a lack of confidence.
Yeah.
And usually from fathers that didn't undermine the boy's confidence. And so they're often attracted to science and engineering kind of professions. And what happens is that they think that homeopathy is a hoax.
Yeah.
Basically, because they're not looking at chemical complexes. There's not been a lot of theory. It's not well known. And for 200 years, it's been basically getting down, you know, being defamed as the same type as quackery or as a hoax or something. However, what's kept it alive is that there are doctors that kind of go, well, we don't know what it is or anything, but we can see that it works. And it works amazingly well in most cases. And so they use it, and it's been used in epidemics, and it's outperformed regular medicine 10 to 1.
Well, they're bastards, you know? This is ridiculous.
Oh, it's very, it's infuriating, but
yeah.
But I found that basically I had to get up on my hind legs and start going after these guys. I had to counterattack.
I saw that. I mean, you did a great job on YouTube. It was unbelievable,
thank you.
Actually. I mean, this guy, I don't remember his name. That other guy you talk about, what a jackass.
Novella.
Oh, Christ save us all, huh? This guy, what's his beef? What's his problem? I mean, for real.
Well, it's the same thing. I mean, a lot of these guys aren't practitioners. Most of them, in fact, none of them that I've found are practitioners. None of them are medical practitioners. And there are medical practitioners who do use, I mean, medical doctors, you know, here in the United States who are using homeopathy in their practice, some intravenously.
Intravenously.
But it's the same thing. These people have taken a position on it because they don't know that much about it or its uses. They really haven't looked that much at it. They just basically dismiss it as quackery. They're ridiculing it. And so anything that comes along that's going to prove it, of scientific support of it, makes them look stupid.
You said he's not even a doctor. I mean, who the hell is this guy? Come on.
Well, he is. Yeah, he does have a. He does. I think he's got a medical degree. He's a neurologist, but he doesn't practice. He's not a practicing doctor.
There it is. There's always something.
Yeah, and.
All right. Thanks.
We had it was 20 minutes, so that was less than half.
Talk.
Yeah, I let him go. I wanted to hear him say a lot of stuff. We got into a lot of other stuff. He was talking about like the structure, these nanostructures that homeopathy creates. And, you know, he basically, his general message was that modern science is full of shit. And, yeah. And you know, putting down Steve, putting down Randi.
Now, Randi, your daddy didn't love you? Is that your problem?
I'm surprised at his reaction. Yeah, I can't believe it.
Oh, Randi, this guy did an entire video on you. Yeah. And here's the other thing. I really did think that... Oh, we'll get him, Randi. We'll get him. See, it's actually bad for Bennett because with the black and white video, Steve and I talked about it. We thought he was crazy. Then we're like, you know, we want to stay away from the crazies. I talked to him. He's not crazy. He's just an asshole.
Technically speaking.
Yeah. So I'm not done with him yet. I'm not done. He's going to hear from Phillips again, my guy. Thank you. And I gave him the crazy name. Yeah, he wants my name. He's sending me emails now. It's the beginning of a relationship.
Well, lucky you.
So we were still playing Name Not Logical Fallacy. I hope you were paying attention. Lots of arguments from authority, you know, lots of ad hominem attacks, false premises, non sequiturs. He pretty much was running the whole list. But the other thing is, yeah, we're picking on this one guy, you know, because he picked on us. But what he's saying, he gave the standard homeopathy apologist position. You can hear that from anyone. That's Dana Ullman's position. Anyone who is basically, you know, Fisher, all these guys who are the prominent, world-famous homeopaths, that's it. He's, you know, verbatim from those guys in terms of what the standard line is. That we dismiss it because we don't really know the evidence, which is wrong. That, you know, that there are, we dismiss or ignore the scientific evidence that it works. They do massive cherry picking of the evidence. When, of course, systematic review after systematic review shows that it doesn't work. But really, that's as good as it gets. So that's our tribute to Homeopathy Awareness Week.
Steve, there's a fact here that I haven't really publicized very much, but I did a test with the Royal Society in London. They designed the protocol for it in conference with the homeopaths, with Ullman and with the rest of them, and they all agreed that the protocol was quite sound and such. And we did it for BBC, mm-hmm. And the BBC called me and asked me if I would put up the $1 million prize, and I said, yes, I'll forego the preliminary test and we'll award it directly should they win this test, because I knew the Royal Society was behind it and that they would do a good test, you see. And so I told them at the same time, I said, but I don't want to hear a word about it until it's already been done 48 hours after the results are in. Store them in the computer. Don't draw the conclusion. Don't summarize it up as to whether or not the results are positive or negative. Then call me and tell me it's been done. And they said, but why? And I said, because they say that I put out evil vibrations across the ocean, of course. It's like volcanic ash, you see, the same kind of thing. And that interferes with the test because I know they're being done at that time, so I put out the evil vibrations to interfere with it. So I said, I don't want to know when it's happened, only 48 hours after it. You see, so, because time travel may be possible, but not for more than 48 hours, I believe.
Of course, yeah. I thought it was 7 days.
But and so when they called me and they said, we've done the test, do you want to know the results? I said, no one should know the results, yes, the summary of it. The statistician probably knows, but I don't want to know. And you want me to go there? Yet? And I flew over there. I showed up and I sat at the table. And the BBC did a cunning thing on me, by the way, which I find it hard to forgive. I had laryngitis. I developed it in the plane somehow. And I was talking about like this.
You didn't take your airplane?
I had to clear my throat repeatedly, and they had a hard time doing a tape that was intelligible, so I didn't say very much during the interview when they were about to bring it up on the computer screen in front of me via the statistician. And so what the BBC did, they edited in a piece where they said something to the effect, are you worried about the results? And I said, no, I'm not the least bit concerned about it. And it made me look as if I was really scared. I had no trepidation about the thing at all. I knew very well that it was quackery and nonsense, and my $1 million, not my $1 million, the JRAF's $1 million was perfectly safe. However, they sort of rang in that little thing to build some tension. They have a guy who used to work for soap operas, I think, and they probably wrote that part of the text. But when they brought it up on the screen, it was exactly what I expected. The error bars were here on the graph, and the data was all in between the error bars very safely and very succinctly. But I thought I would mention the fact that I said, don't tell me about it until it's been done for 48 hours because of this possibility that they do bring up the evil vibrations.
Yeah, you have to anticipate any possible stupid thing they could say, basically.
Yes.
Yeah.
Like we're all atheists and therefore, therefore we don't believe in homeopathy.
And some of us are even gay, can you imagine?
Yes. Don't get me started.
Yeah. Those are gay-theists.
What gay-theists. A combination. Now, if you were French and gay and an atheist, what combination could beat that? I mean, that's the most negative person in the world. Moving right along.
Moving right along. Jay, what am I looking at here? What is that?
That is a barcode scanner that can... It's actually got an incredibly dangerous label on it. It says, can kill, can
it looks like a dangerous weapon.
Yeah, if you hit someone with it, maybe.
This is a stupid little story that's going around the internet right now. There was a 12-year-old girl that went into some type of store with her grandmother. And I guess one of the people that works there kind of shot the thing at the girl. And later on, they immediately get attorneys. And later on, they filed a lawsuit that said that she got burned by the scanner, and it gave her Tourette's. So just a little bit of information about these types of scanners. They have LED lights in them. There's I'm not an expert on this. I'm doing research on the web. But from what I read, there's three different levels of LED light, 1, 2, and 3. And basically, 1 and 2... predominate the use in these types of devices, and they can't really do any damage. Even if you did look at them, they wouldn't do any long-term damage. The third level light could, if you overexposed yourself to it. So like a quick flash like that wouldn't do anything. Even maybe for a few minutes, it wouldn't do anything. You'd have to really try to hurt yourself. So the chances of this girl actually getting injured by a quick scan like that or whatever, even a laser light from what we recently found out can't do that much damage unless you held it in your eye with it on for 5 minutes or something, and then it could do some damage. So a quick flash of these LED lights really couldn't do anything. I'm going to let Steve talk about Tourette's, but the baseline here is that people are just taking advantage of this. We're so happy in this country, number one. Number two, there's no way this device burned her or caused her actual Tourette's.
Well, yeah, I mean, in this particular story, I mean, the girl had diagnoses preceding her exposure to the scanner. And, the plausibility of a neurological disorder like Tourette's syndrome, that's where you have basically a compulsive disorder. It usually goes hand in hand with obsessive compulsive disorder, right? So you have obsessions, things that you can't stop thinking about. And then also compulsions like hand washing or checking behavior. And that goes hand in hand with Tourette syndrome, which is kind of like a motor compulsion. It's a tic. You have a building within you the desire to do something, to clear your throat, to shrug your shoulders, to do some kind of tic. And it can only be relieved by doing the tic. So you can voluntarily control it, but only for a short period of time because the need to do that movement becomes overwhelming.
And it's always, it's forever. Often a verbal thing, too,
It
I
could
understand.
Be verbal, yeah, throat clearing is common. Sometimes, I think what the lay perception is that it's swearing, but that's only one type of tic. The compulsion to do something that's socially unacceptable, is basically what it is.
Is it genetic? Because I did read that part of it could be from environmental...
It's one of those things where it's genetically predisposed, but it has to interact with environmental factors. So we haven't really narrowed down on the exact cause of it, because it's complicated.
So let's say that the little girl got shot in the eye with this or something, and she was horrified, say, of these types of scanners. Could that have emotionally been enough to push her over the edge?
No. No, I mean, that's not going to cause Tourette's. I wouldn't even really exacerbate it. I mean, certainly stress will lower someone's ability to deal with it, and the tics may become more prominent when they're under stress, And maybe if she was afraid of the scanner and she was stressed out because of it, that might have made her momentarily the symptoms worse. It wouldn't have actually worsened the underlying disorder itself, just made the symptoms temporarily worse. That's the worst possible thing that could happen. But that's just from her being, you know, unreasonably afraid of the scanner. But what the amazing thing of this story is that lawyers took up the case. That's the thing that I have a hard time. Now, I'm not going to bash lawyers, because, you know, I actually work with a lot of attorneys, and my experience is that most of them are quite reasonable, and they actually, you know, you have to get an expert to say that, yes, A caused B, right? And so these lawyers should not be going forward with this case unless they found some expert somewhere who's willing to testify in court that scanner caused the girl's Tourette syndrome. I'd like to talk to that guy. Maybe it was a homeopath. Maybe they found a homeopath. And they usually try to find people who are going to stand up to cross-examination. You know, you can't get an expert, you know, whose credentials and opinions are going to collapse under, you know, even a Mickey Mouse cross-examination. So it sounds like a bit of incompetent lawyering to me.
Don't they, in the beginning, don't they just vet out, doesn't a judge hear that the preliminary case?
No.
I thought a judge had to accept it as a legitimate case.
No, you just have to meet all the criteria. You have to get an expert willing to say that it caused it. If you get an expert to sign off on it, to say, yes, this is a legitimate case, that's enough. The judge doesn't decide. So most cases, in fact, most cases that I review never go to trial because there's no case. An expert says, I'm sorry, but there's no case here. I mean, obviously, if this came over my desk, I would say, no, this is not a legitimate cause and effect. You cannot go forward with this. My opinion is the scanner did not cause the Tourette's, and you know, the evidence shows it wouldn't cause any burns. So it's a combination of a lawyer and an expert willing to come together to proceed with this in order to, for this kind of ridiculous case to go forward. Again, this is all, I always have to say this, assuming that the reporting that we're getting is legitimate, because there's always that layer of journalism in there, and we get burned on this all the time, that really the real story is different, but the journalist pulled out something ridiculous. And because this is a personal case, I mean, there's no way, you know, there's confidentiality involved here. There's no way I can really do fact-checking on this. So, caveat: if what they're reporting is true, it's a ridiculous case. But I wouldn't be surprised if the real story is actually vastly different.
Where are we with the case, though?
It started Monday of last week.
Yeah. So, which means it'll be a couple of years probably before it.
Steve, our audience might be interested to know just how peculiar this Tourette syndrome is. The first time I came, I had heard about it. The first time I came upon it in the flesh, so to speak, I was standing on a waiting platform for the Underground in London. In the middle of the day, there was hardly anyone around, just a police officer walking up and down doing his rounds. And there was a very well-dressed businessman, an English fellow with the furled umbrella, the whole thing. And he was standing at the edge and looking for his train coming. And he was clearing his throat several times. And then he came up with this most surprising thing. Son of a bitch, fuck, fuck, fuck. and then he dropped his head again, and he looked around, and he saw me looking astonished, and he came over to me and said, "Sir, did I say something inappropriate?" He didn't know. Yeah. Wow. His mind shuts off for that moment, and he came up with this sort of thing, and he said, "Oh, I must apologize." He said, "I have Tourette's syndrome." And he said, "Please forgive me." Now, in a very calm and logical voice like this,
right.
And while he was talking to me, he went very, very quickly like this. And he said, "Did I do it again? Oh, I'm very, very sorry." He said, "I should go home now." And he walked for the stairs, and he went up the stairs, and I believe he left the Underground because he was having a bout of this sort of thing. But it's involuntary, and it has then this amnesic quality that
they
forget about.
Well, I think they just don't pay attention to it. It's just part of the background. You know, it's like you're not aware of every little thing you're doing either.
Like clearing your throat.
Yeah, clearing, scratching your elbow or something. We kind of do all these things subconsciously. So there is no amnesia technically associated with it. It's just probably he just wasn't paying attention. Also, he may have been using that and exaggerating the degree to which he was not aware of it as a way of dealing with the social embarrassment. And that's the biggest part of the Tourette's, is that it's just, it doesn't really hurt them, but it can be socially devastating, right? That's the
I would have loved to meet Tourette. That would be an experience, wouldn't it?
Steve, can they fire you if you have Tourette's?
Oh, no. Well, not in, I'm sure that's covered by the American with Disabilities Act. I mean,
so I could do this at work.
Jay.
Because I have a lot to say to my boss.
You can get away with a lot of commentary and be forgiven for it and paid for it.
Right.
Wow.
Right.
And then I won't remember any of it.
Temporary Tourette's, right?
Temporary.
Cured next
situational.
Week.
Situational. Situational Tourette's, we call it. Yeah. Who's this funny looking monkey? Simon Singh, the man who was sued by the British Chiropractic Association. This slide is just up here, just in case anyone in the audience doesn't know. The BCA dropped their libel case against Simon Singh, who has now essentially won the case.
Yes. And that Simon also stands to be able to collect his expenses, considerable expenses, £100,000 or so that he spent on defense of this case. He stands a good chance of collecting that under English law. And that's another reason for celebration, I would say.
I wonder if he can get some punitive reward as well, because he spent the last year of his life doing nothing but having to defend himself
The answer, I believe, is no.
So, and he will be at TAM in Las Vegas coming up very shortly.
Ooh, awesome.
So if you haven't registered, go there just to hear Simon Singh speak.
So the numbers that I've heard are he spent £200,000 out of pocket, which I understand is real money. It's, you know, it's not dollars, but I think it's like $400,000. And he stands to recuperate about £180,000 of that, all but about £20,000. And yes, recuperate. And but the 2 years of lost work essentially is lost. He does not get that back. Right.
Yes. And he got great support from the skeptical community all over the world. Very, very vociferous comments on it. We supported him, and he certainly deserved it.
Yeah.
Randy, how did when Uri Geller sued you? Okay, so how long did that take to settle? And how many years of your life were essentially lost?
It's Uri Geller, not Uri Geller. Please.
Whatever.
Okay, don't blame the Russians for him. No, they can be blamed for a lot of things, but not for Uri Geller. Now, it cost me most of my MacArthur grant, which was about $270,000, $272,000 to be exact, $1,000 over the years. It cost me to defend myself against Geller, but it cost him nothing because he did it on a contingency basis, convinced his lawyers that they would all share in millions of dollars that James Randi has. And by the way, it's interesting that every time that he sues me, and I guess sues most people, he uses a different legal firm because he either doesn't pay his bills or they suddenly realize that he was fibbing to them when he said that I had so much money that they could sue me for. So, yes, it cost me years of my life, literally, to defend myself.
All right. Anybody know what that is?
That's a confectionery that you can buy out in the lobby here.
It's an organelle. It's meta material.
Is it an organelle?
It's an organelle. It's a mitochondria. It's a drawing of a mitochondria. It's not a real picture. Mitochondria are the little energy factories inside every cell, and they essentially make energy, ATP, out of oxygen and sugar and the byproducts of sugar, actually. They're the ones to make all your energy. They are organelles that probably evolved symbiotically with the first eukaryotes, in that it's like a bacteria-like organism that combined with, you know, early cells. And the part of the reason we believe that is that they have their own DNA. And the DNA code for mitochondrial DNA is just a little bit different than the DNA code for everything else.
A year or so?
So, yeah, so they probably come branched off from the rest of life that we know of on this planet, you know, before everything else that we know. I mean, it's really, really archaic. The reason why we're talking about the mitochondria is because in the UK, some doctors are trying to develop a treatment for a mitochondrial disorder. Now, there are a set of genetic disorders that are the mitochondrial myopathies, actually part of my subspecialty, that you inherit only from the mother, because mothers pass on mitochondria to their children through their eggs, but the sperm has very few, if any, mitochondria. So you get almost no mitochondria from your father and all your mitochondria from your mother. So that's convenient for geneticists, because we can follow just the maternal line through mitochondrial analysis. And we've talked about that with regard to evolution from time to time on the show. Now, for mitochondrial diseases, where some, you know, most of the proteins and everything that make up a mitochondria are actually in the mitochondria itself, its own DNA, but some of them come from nuclear DNA, the cell's regular DNA. But for those that come from the mitochondria itself, for mutations that cause really serious diseases with weakness and, you know, deafness, blindness, seizures, strokes, really serious neurological disorders, there is the potential for essentially curing or preventing these disorders from occurring by using a cloning type of technique. So imagine if you take an in vitro fertilization, you know, the egg from a woman, the sperm from a man, you fertilize it in the petri dish, now you have a fertilized egg, then you use a cloning technique, you take the nucleus out of that fertilized egg, and you transplant it into another egg where you've taken out the nucleus. So that's essentially what cloning is. Now what you have are the DNA from the mother and the father and the mitochondrial DNA from the other egg donor. So the child would literally have three parents, right? Two nuclear DNA parents and one mitochondrial DNA mother. That is a way of essentially preventing 100% any mitochondrial genetic disease. Makes a lot of sense. And you don't have to futz around with the nuclear DNA itself. So it's not really genetic engineering, right? You're not inserting genes or taking out genes. You're not altering the nuclear DNA at all. You're just sort of putting it into a cell with good mitochondria, so you don't get the cell with the bad mitochondria.
So just to clarify, it's not like the child will have an equal mix of all three parents as far as looks and everything. It's just like inserting this stuff into a cell.
Genetically, in terms of what the kid looks like, it would look like the two parents that donated the sperm and the egg would not look at all like the woman who donated the egg with the mitochondria. All she's contributing really is the mitochondria. I mean, it's also all the other stuff in the cell as well, but that's, you know, the cytoplasm and everything. But that's, you know, negligible. The real thing is that persists is the mitochondrial DNA. Mm-hmm. So it's interesting. It's neat. It's a way to have three parents without really doing genetic engineering, and it would treat a really horrible suite of diseases. However, in the UK, where this research is being done, it's illegal. It's illegal to do anything resembling human cloning, and this is kind of skirting with the edge because you're not really doing a clone, and you're not doing any kind of genetic engineering. You're just sort of swapping out the mitochondria. So this has now come up in the UK as a controversial case, and it'd be very interesting to see what happens with it. Because in my opinion, this is a very effective cure for a horrible set of diseases, and I personally don't see any ethical problems with doing this. I really don't even think this should be considered cloning or genetic engineering. It's really just mitochondrial therapy, if you want to call it something else. But it's causing a row now in the UK, and we have to wait and see how this pans out as far as the laws are concerned. But right now, they're saying it's against the existing statutes in the UK against human reproductive cloning, which is what
Steve,
they're calling it.
Is it obvious, though, to parents that my kid is going to have mitochondrial problems, but they have kids anyway, or is it accidental, like, oh, wow, I didn't anticipate this? Will it prevent the accidental births that people didn't even know?
It's a good question. I mean, it's passed down through the maternal line,
right,
and most of them are dominant. So if your mother is a carrier, if your mother has the disease, she will pass it down to all of her kids, right? Because
right?
She contributes almost all the mitochondria to every child. But sometimes the diseases don't really have their clinical onset until the 20s or later. So you may have kids before you get diagnosed.
Okay.
When would they have to do this procedure? At what point?
Well, it's part of in vitro fertilization.
Okay.
So you would undergo in vitro fertilization with this extra added step in, and you need to get a third donor to do it. Yeah. So very interesting technology, but it's getting embroiled in the old ethics dilemma.
Should we do questions? We only have 15 minutes left.
No, we're doing to 120, right?
Okay. Never
so
mind.
We're going to do I think just one more quick news item. Yep. And then we'll go on to science or fiction, and then we'll do your questions. So this is a quick one. This is just a funny item. Have you guys heard of
the...
Looks
fun.
Oh, yeah. Croatian girl who was in a coma for a few days, and when she awoke from the coma, She was speaking fluent German. You guys heard the story?
Jawohl.
Jawohl, mein Gott. Right.
Bestimmt. Ja,
Jay?
Ja. Wait. Come on. Come on, so she wakes up and she's speaking in a German accent?
No.
Speaking German?
No, no. Fluent German.
All right, let's clarify a few obvious things here. What language did she speak as a child?
Croatian.
Okay, how close is Croatia to Germany?
Well, it's not German.
All right, just not a German language. Not Germanic in any way.
I don't know if it's Germanic, but it doesn't matter. It's not fluent German.
She has never been instructed of German in any way.
Well, now you're getting detailed now. So it turns out, you know, that when you actually read the details of the case, that she was studying German.
Oh, come on, really?
Really. What? So she, in fact, could speak it quite well before the coma.
And this is news? Why?
So the news is that she woke up and spoke in the other language she knows.
Right. Right.
We had a perfectly good myth going there, and you destroyed it completely.
It's a miracle.
But apparently, according to her mother, she speaks German better after the coma than before.
Well, there you go.
According to the mother, yeah.
Right, there we go. That was a news story. Okay. But the point was just to make Jay say a stupid German accent.
I really, all I could do is talk about Hitler right now, and I'm not doing
okay.
it.
Okay. All right.
It's too bad that we don't have Brian Dunning on the show, because he does a horrible German accent. You guys ever heard Brian Dunning's horrible German accent?
Sorry, Brian.
He was ragging on us for making fun of his German accent, so now, of course, we have to do it every time it comes up. All right.
Steve, yes. One thing, if I may. Yes. About the Simon Singh case, ladies and gentlemen, I hope you understand the importance of this finding against the British Chiropractic Association, because this may mark a turning point in UK law, where scientists have been sued constantly for making any kind of comment about another scientist or about some discovery or supposed discovery. They get sued regularly. It's very easy in the UK to sue on civil charges and whatnot. And this has been happening increasingly, and it's been suppressing a lot of scientific opinions that would otherwise be expressed. This may make the Simon Singh case, and it'll get to be known as that, I'm sure, I certainly hope so. This could be a turning point in UK law, and it may very well serve to influence us as well in that same respect.
Absolutely. Okay, so it's time now for science or fiction. All right. So at our live events, what we're going to do is I'm going to read all three items. You can see them up there, but I will read all three items. Then we will survey the audience through applause to see which ones you guys think are which one is the fiction. Then we'll get some advice from our panel of skeptical experts, and we'll see how much influence it had on you, and then I'll do the reveal. So here we go. Item number one. Researchers find that drugs like morphine and heroin may protect the brain from HIV-associated dementia. Item number two, a new study finds that late-night video game playing significantly delays sleep onset in teenagers. And item number three, physicists create a true random number generator exploiting quantum entanglement as the source of randomness. Let you read those over for a couple of seconds. Now again, applaud for the one that you think is the fiction. How many people in the audience think the HIV-associated dementia one is the fiction? How many think that video games delay sleep onset is the fiction? And how many think that the random number generator using quantum entanglement is the fiction? All right. So it sounded like three, then one, then two, I think is my interpretation of that. So I guess we'll start with you, Bob, and then we'll work our way down. You want to help these guys out a little bit?
Start with Randi. tilt it over here, Steve. All right, I can see it. All right, I can see, number one kind of makes sense to me. I can see morphine and heroin changing the brain in such a way that it could protect you. I wasn't even aware of HIV-associated dementia in the first place, so that's kind of interesting. It kind of makes sense. It doesn't really surprise me. late night video game. The link sleep onset, isn't that obvious? I mean, you're playing.
So to clarify.
Oh, please.
This is not that people are not going to sleep because they're playing video games. It means that when they go to sleep, it takes them longer to fall asleep.
Right.
The sleep onset is a technical term for how long it takes you from the time that you lay down and try to get to sleep to the time you actually are asleep.
Right. Oh, I got that. Well, you know, when you kill aliens for 3 hours, I could see how you're all hyped up and it takes a while to get settled down, so that kind of still makes sense to me. The third one, I have always read that a true random number generator is, I think the word used was impossible. That's kind of making me lean towards that one. But on the other hand, I could see how quantum entanglement can be used as a source of randomness as well, because people try to use entanglement to say that, oh, we're going to communicate over millions of light years potentially using entanglement, and you can't because it's essentially random events. You can't encode a signal in random events. So that's random, but I'm still going to go with what I've read in the past saying that a true random number generator is true, right? Is impossible. I'm going to go with that.
Okay, Fobecca.
Well, it seems like video games are always getting a bad rap for everything, so I'm just going to get this over with as quickly as possible. That one sounds pretty obvious, so I'm going to go with that as the fiction because Steve is evil.
Did you say Steve is Stevel?
The Rebecca method. Jay?
Item number one, it's the one about the heroin and morphine delaying or protecting the brain from HIV, I mean from associated dementia. Yeah, I'd never heard of it, and I don't know enough about it to comment other than it seems like a lot of patients that are suffering from late stages of HIV would be on those drugs, and there's probably enough people doing it where they had some type of study involved. The video game playing, absolutely. I mean, I've heard from many doctors, including my own, and read many times that, you know, you play video games late or even watching TV late or anything that is stimulating will make it, it takes longer for you to fall asleep, right? So you're increasing your brain activity from watching those things and hearing things, so I definitely agree on that. Real quick, though, who here plays Modern Warfare 2 on Xbox? What's up, my brothers? Physicists create a true random number generator. Steve, how can this possibly be true? A true random number generator, meaning 1 to infinity. Do I have to even go on? I can't. How? How can we generate an infinite number?
No.
Wrong.
Bob, you want to help him out a little bit?
Huh?
Want to help him out with that a little bit?
What? Go ahead.
It's not going to create an infinite number of generators. It's going to create numbers with no pattern that you could divine.
It's not a random number then, because it's excluding those super, super high numbers.
No.
Right?
I don't think you're getting it, Jay.
Are you saying a random number generator between 1 and 10?
Sure.
Or Jay, it could just be a 1 and 0. Just a random one. It could be binary.
Right.
It doesn't have to be.
You could set the range. Well, you
that's not written there, so now you're changing it.
You could set the range, so that's not.
Okay, so we've officially changed the parameter in item number 3. So I'll start over. Item number 1. It's 3, come on.
Okay, it's the random number generator.
Right.
All right, Evan?
Like my colleagues, I had no idea HIV associated dementia existed. No clue. I think that one is science. I'm caught between the video games and the random number generator, which in a way are kind of associated, I think. Well, I'm a bad example because I fall asleep very well. I'm a good sleeper, and I can fall asleep pretty much. I can think myself, and 10 seconds later, I'm asleep. So I don't think I'm a good indicator, or I can't use my own personal experience to help make that assumption.
It's anecdotal anyway.
Way too anecdotal. But this true random number generator thing is very interesting because I really hadn't heard about that either. I wasn't aware that you can't, that computers could not simulate that or come up with that. So I'm having a hard time wrapping my mind around that one. I'm forced to choose. The random number generator one is fiction.
Okay, Randy?
Well, with number one, I think that people who involve themselves a lot in morphine and heroin may not care about the dementia. So maybe it's just that they don't care. They experience and they say, the same old thing, you know. But number three bothers me because it says a true random number generator. Within what limits? Now, true, that covers the whole spectrum and everything, so it's impossible to do it.
Thank you.
There's no question of it.
That was Jay's point. Right?
On the other hand, for practical purposes, several degrees of randomization certainly will give you something that's practical, that can be used, and such, but true random number generator damns the whole thing right there, because I think theoretically that is impossible, but not practically. I'm going to say that the item number two, I don't care about at all. I just
the video games. Randi, yeah. You don't play Modern Warfare 2.
But it seems to me I had heard something about item number one. That may be true. It just might be. I'll sort of vote for that.
Well, which one's the fiction, Randi?
Sorry?
Which one is not true?
Which one is not true? I think that item number three is not true.
The random number generator. Okay.
Yes.
So that seems to be pretty in line with what the audience already thought. But let's quickly poll you again. Who thinks that HIV-associated dementia is the fiction? Video games delaying sleep onset? And random number generator? All right. So did push you all a little bit in the direction of the random number generator. We'll take these in order. We'll start with number one. Researchers find that drugs like morphine and heroin may protect the brain from HIV-associated dementia. That one is science.
50-50 now. Good.
And actually, the researchers had the opposite hypothesis. They were concerned, a lot of people who do have HIV, the human immunodeficiency virus, one population are heroin abusers. So they do, abuse heroin. And also, many may be using morphine therapeutically. So there are a lot of people who have HIV, especially late stage, who actually are being exposed to morphine and heroin. They thought that it actually might be positively correlated with HIV dementia and might be contributing cause of it. And they found the opposite, that it had a very unexpected protective effect. So therefore, now they're careful to point out, they're not recommending that people start abusing heroin in order to protect themselves from HIV dementia. But what they said is that if they could find out which receptors these opiates are binding to, that could lead to drug development for a drug that could then protect against HIV-associated dementia without the unwanted side effects of morphine and heroin. Maybe not
mostly
so
unwanted.
Right, mostly unwanted. So yeah, there is an HIV-associated dementia. Some percentage, about 10 to 15% of patients with late HIV will start to have progressive neuronal damage and will have a fairly significant dementia. Right now, the only treatment for that is to just increase their antiretroviral drugs, the drugs they're probably already taking to treat the HIV, to keep their titers really low. But it's not really much. It's not a directed treatment. It's not really that effective. It's just something to do. All right, let's go on to item number two. A new study finds that late night video game playing significantly delays sleep onset in teenagers. I believe that Liz was the only one who thought that this one was fiction on the panel, and a minority of people in the audience also thought this one was the fiction. And this one is the fiction. 100%.
Hey, Liz.
I'm so happy right now.
Curse you, Rebecca.
True number generator. Awesome.
Hold on.
All right, I'll wait.
Careful. Slow down, bud.
Also,
this is bullshit.
That's what the researchers said. So this is also went contrary to the working hypothesis of the researchers. Now, prior studies have shown that there is a correlation between sleep deprivation and video game playing. And for obvious reasons, what previous studies have shown is that people underestimate the amount of time they spend playing video games. They underestimate the amount of sleep that they sacrifice in order to keep playing their video games and the degree of their sleep deprivation, especially teenagers. So there's a high degree of sleep deprivation and not really a lot of awareness of it among video game players. And they also, if you separate out video game addicts, which are defined as more than 7 hours a week, 7 hours?
Yeah.
It doesn't take, I could hit that in one day.
Right.
I mean, addict. Steve,
yeah.
You don't understand. They killed Charlie, you know? Like, you guys know what I'm talking about.
Two of them do.
Yeah. We'll admit to, yeah. So they say, okay, well, let's see, maybe there's another effect. Maybe it's just not that people are going to bed later because they're playing video games. Maybe, as Bob and others, you know, pointed out, that it's activating. It's not a good thing to be doing. You have to come down from your first-person shooter high right before you go to sleep. And it turns out that there was only a slight difference. There was no significant difference between sleep onset in teenagers from playing video games versus not playing video games. So that's not the problem. The problem is you're staying up till 2 in the morning playing video games, right? So that was a little bit of a surprise and very interesting, which made it a perfect science or fiction. Now, item number 3. Physicists create a true random number generator exploiting quantum entanglement as the source of randomness. Now, a true random number generator has a very specific definition. It's, you know, the ability to generate a truly statistically random sequence of digits. It doesn't have to be, obviously, any number from 0 to infinity. And in fact, in this case, it was a binary system. It was just a 0 or a 1. Now, Bob, it's impossible to have a classical system that's a true random number generator.
So I'm right. I was right.
Classical system, right. It's only theoretically possible to have a true random number generator from a quantum system. That's I think, what you were remembering.
Well, all right, explain all that.
So
classic is the macro world, but you know, the
yeah.
Quantum is tiny, tiny.
More or less. Beyond nano, yeah. Oh, yeah. So the you can have only pseudo-random numbers from a classical system, because in a classical system, theoretically, you could actually predict the outcome of any physical system if you know enough information about the starting point. So it's not truly random, and it can never be truly random. Great, because you could actually predict, and that's, you know, what would the outcome be if you knew the initial conditions. But with quantum systems, at the quantum level itself, it is truly random. It's the physics of the universe is random at that level, right? You cannot predict what the outcome is going to be, no matter how much you know about initial conditions. So it's only theoretically possible to have a truly random number generator with a quantum system.
So wait. So when you're saying on the quantum level, there is no way ever that we'd be able to predict anything.
Right. There are certain quantum properties. Remember Einstein's quip, God does not play dice with the universe. This is the dice, right? The dice is the random number generator within the quantum systems. You know, where's the electron going to be at any point in time?
So you're saying empirically the information does not exist.
Yeah, as far as we know, as physicists know experimentally, you cannot predict the quantum state of a system until it makes a choice and
right, and actually through superposition it's actually both zero and one, interacting with the environment, decoherence is what actually somehow one is picked, and that's what's random. So that's kind of what they're tapping into. That's awesome.
Yeah, I don't think that's technically decoherence, but it is the
what?
I don't think decoherence is the right term for
you know
that,
in modern
right?
warfare
that's too that's when you said you're wrong, Bob.
What? You can pick that's one of an array of weapons. Good stuff,
Steve,
man.
Steve, it goes into superposition when it interacts with the environment and decoheres, then one is select. One
doesn't
is,
that only
one
refer to when two particles are entangled? Decoherence? No. All right.
No, you don't need entanglement for superposition.
I know, but does that term refer to every quantum state collapsing? I think the collapse of the wave function is probably a better term for that.
Okay.
But whatever. I have quantum mechanics emailing me complaining about whatever I call it. So it's one of those things, a collapse, let's call it the collapse of the wave function.
So it's basically random whether or not you're right.
Yes, it's truly random.
No, you're right.
No.
Number 3, it's random whether or not this is actually...
No, it's correct. So this is what the researchers did. They were able to create a quantum entanglement and that would, when it did collapse, it would give off a photon, and then they were able to use the information in that. I guess they didn't go into that much detail, but there was some aspect of the photon that was able to generate randomly with proven statistical randomness, either a 0 or a 1. And they were able to use that, therefore, as a random number generator that met all the criteria, both physically and also statistically, of a true random number generator. I didn't want to say it was the first one, because I couldn't prove that to myself by digging into this, and it's theoretically not the first one, so it's just one. I didn't say it was the first one. I didn't want to be, accidentally wrong, by saying something I couldn't verify.
I wonder how many trials I had to do to determine true randomness.
It took months to do this study. It's a really slow random number generator, because they have to create the entanglement and then let the wave function collapse and measure it, and it took them a really long time. So the bits were trickling in very slowly over time. Wouldn't really be functionally useful for like a 256-bit security key, but that's the ultimate goal with this, right? You want to be able to generate a truly random key for security reasons. The problem with the pseudo-random number, so if on your desktop, You know, those of you who like still remember how to program in BASIC or whatever, or any program on your PC or Mac that requires some kind of random numbers, those are fake random numbers, right? They use some kind of method to simulate random numbers. The most common black box method of generating fake random numbers is that they have a statistically random sequence of numbers, but they're already memorized in the computer.
Pre-programmed.
It's pre-programmed. They're pre-programmed random numbers. It's fake. Of course, you can't tell if all you're doing is getting the output because it meets statistical criteria for randomness, but you may not realize that some guy somewhere knows all your random numbers, right? So it's not really useful for security purposes. You need some way of generating what they call private randomness. You need private random numbers, not just
all right,
statistically
Steve,
random
Steve,
numbers.
You got us.
Yeah, it did.
You won. Most of us chose wrongly.
Thank
We're good.
You.
We got the random number thing. Let's go.
All right.
Steve, I'm really glad this went well for me, because before science or fiction, I was getting the quantum jitters.
You were getting the quantum jitters? Yeah.
Yes.
No one understood that, did they?
Yeah. Did you collapse, though? Did your wave function collapse?
Steve, quick question. What was entangled?
Actually, there were photons that they entangled.
Okay.
Yeah. So that's about the level of detail that I was able to dig down. Okay. So,
well, as soon as I get out of here, I'm going to call Chip Denman, the official statistician, professional statistician for the JREF, and I'm going to ask him this question about number three there. What are the chances of that?
100% apparently, because they did it.
So, Steve, when you do the year-end review and you do the stats for science fiction, can you tell everyone that I got
Liz,
100% of my...
But now we got to get you back just so I could trick you and get your stats down to less than 100%.
Well, and let me tell you a little anecdote, if I may. Of course I may. One audience, I used to do a mentalism trick, and I still do it occasionally, for my audiences when I lecture on parapsychology and whatnot, my specialty, and I would do a little mentalism trick. And I asked a lady, now what I do is I take a ping pong ball, turn my back to the audience, throw it over my shoulder, and the nearest person who catches it, that's always a laugh too, because it always hits the floor, and they have to search for it. The person who retrieves the ping pong ball is the person I choose, or they can hand it off to somebody else if they don't choose to be the volunteer. So a lady stood up looking very nervous, and I said, ma'am, I would like you to give me, please, a three-digit random number, any old three-digit number whatsoever. And she looked a little fuddled, and she said, 1, 2, 3. And the audience laughed. And as you might see, you laugh too, you see? Thank you very much. And she reacts very well to cues, you notice? And I said, no, just a random number, like take an old telephone number of yours and mix up three of the digits or something. She said, 3, 2, 1. And of course, the audience laughed louder at that point, as you did. And I looked at her and I said, wait a minute. I said, ladies and gentlemen, this lady is perfectly correct. Well, what is your problem, do you think, ma'am? She says, but I don't know any random numbers. And I said, exactly, you don't know any random numbers. Nobody knows any random numbers. But that was a lesson to me. The lady was absolutely right. A little more confused than she might have been, but she was absolutely right. No one knows any random numbers.
Right. Because we're all biased. If you try to make a random number, it will not be statistically
11-teen.
Random.
There you
11-teen.
Go.
11-1.
Close. Very close.
All right,
close.
We have about 15 minutes for questions. I'm only going to answer questions for people who queue up to the left of my left of the auditorium at the microphone and speak your question into the microphone.
Scramble.
So please form a queue.
No pushing.
And we will answer all your questions.
Try to.
What is the meaning of life?
42.
42, right, come on.
Next.
Give us a hard one.
Begin?
Yes, sir, go ahead.
Okay. 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 I don't think I've ever heard you guys talk about this before, but like my mom watches The Dog Whisperer and all those kinds of shows. I think there's one in like Europe, some British Dog Whisperer. Anyway, what is your take on it? Because I'm watching and, you know, and she tells me, you know, oh, Caesar says that we should do this. Caesar says we should just hold down the dog's neck or something if he's trying to, like, attack us or something.
The British one is bollocks.
I think, okay.
Yeah, right.
Okay.
Does that answer your question?
Basically,
we could go into a little bit more detail. Yeah, The Dog Whisperer, I mean, you know, it's a cold reading, but it's reading through a pet, right? It's still somebody doing a cold reading, and the dog or whatever is just... like the tarot cards or the palm.
They're reading the owner.
Yeah.
Yes, that's right.
They're reading the owner. That's exactly what it is.
Wait, are you asking if Caesar can actually train the animal?
No, well, obviously he's not.
He's talking about Caesar Milan.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, yeah, I mean, if you're talking about, like, the dog wants you to do something, I'm talking more about a pet psychic. You're right. Thanks for clarifying that. Now, just the dog trainer, I'm sure there's some basic skill involved with, maybe even some sophisticated skill in training a dog. But whenever they go beyond just operant conditioning, which is all, quote-unquote, animal training is, then anything where they think that they're, inferring a lot from what the animals are feeling or whatever... I think that's probably cold reading. And also, people have, and Jay does this to me all the time, actually, have a huge tendency to personify what their animals are thinking or feeling.
Oh, yeah.
Right? No, the dog's not trying to punish you.
But Caesar,
it's just doing what it's doing, you know?
Right.
Yeah, I think it's operant conditioning, yeah.
He's really making anything much in the extraordinary claims. He's just really good at what he's doing. It's a very different thing in a pet
psych. Right, right, right. Yeah,
Jay, don't you watch it? The Dog Whisperer? I mean, you've commented on it a lot.
Yeah, I think I think Caesar in particular, the guy has a skill set. He has an affinity with the animals, and I think he actually can do most of the stuff we see him doing on TV. Sure, why not? I mean, dogs are very, very intelligent. They absolutely respond to alpha behavior. Sure, I think he's for real.
Well, if you've ever seen a seeing eye dog, I mean, you know how unbelievably, tight dogs can be trained. So that is... perfectly reasonable.
Yeah.
You know, it's a reality TV show, so we don't know what's really happening. You know, the reality TV shows are written, and there's a story. So I don't believe anything that I see on reality TV. But.
Yeah, the one thing you never see with Caesar, really, like, he doesn't have an epic fail. You don't see him, like, crash and burn enough. I don't think he is successful as much as they show on the show, but I'm sure the guy is a fantastic
That's
trainer.
Called editing.
Yeah, editing, yeah. Right.
Thank you.
Sure.
Hi. I just wanted to start off by saying how disappointed I am in you guys. During the metamaterials section, no one made a ball joke.
Rebecca's in Europe.
Yeah. In case you didn't notice. I got it in my
head. You guys need to pick up the slack. Come on.
I thought of that. I anticipated that. So I really tried not to say ball, and I tried to say sphere. And I don't know if I even succeeded. I don't even remember.
That was low-hanging fruit.
Yeah. Well, but come on.
Satisfied?
Yeah. Well, but I actually want to make a question. I'm new to the medical field, and I'm actually doing stuff with mitochondrial DNA. And the mitochondrial swap you're talking about, I know that our nuclear DNA codes for proteins that the mitochondria needs. Basically, they've shoved some of that, work off on us, and I'm actually developing a sequence capture array to do some genetic sequencing on those to diagnose these diseases. And I'm wondering, because you're a lot better at this than I am, if they did this, nuclear swap, wouldn't those diseases still be a problem, the ones that arise from nuclear mitochondria?
Yes. So if you have a mitochondrial disease that results from nuclear DNA, that would be a problem. That would not be solved by this. This would only solve problems with mitochondrial DNA. But most of the bad, like, you know, Leber's optic atrophy and Milos and Murph, those are like the ones with epilepsy and strokes. Those are mutations in the mitochondrial DNA. So it would work for those.
Thanks.
Yeah.
Hi. First of all, I gotta say I love Modern Warfare 2. Second of all, Steve, 7 hours. What the hell? Really?
Yeah. He doesn't get it, dude. He doesn't know. I mean,
that's not my definition.
By the time you get into the game, I mean, 7 hours is nothing. It's nothing.
It really isn't.
All right, Jay, we get it.
All right, my actual question is, lately I've been thinking about how, well, I'm a teenager, but how people my age really don't, either they don't care or they don't know about most of the things that, you know, a lot of us talk about and think about. And I have my own, like, theories and reasons why I think this is, but I wanted to hear you guys' take on it.
What, why teenagers are not into skepticism? Is that your question?
No, like, why they don't, like, they're not really serious, why, like, everybody hates, like, chemistry class in my school.
These kids today. Don't get me started.
No.
I mean, Plato was saying that, whatever, over 2,000 years ago. I think it's just part of the human condition, to be honest with you. I don't think it's any different.
I don't completely agree with that. I agree, yeah, sure. A lot of older generations are going to look on younger generations as having an attitude problem and everything. I remember I had an attitude problem. You know, I remember...
Had?
I think a lot of people here have had the discussion of how education is going down. It does seem like the parents getting involved to the degree that they used to isn't the same.
Why? Parents are overly involved. They have the helicopter parents who are completely obsessively involved with their kids. That's, you know, it also depends on socioeconomic status. I mean, it's a very complicated issue. I don't think there's any simple answer, like, well, what about parents are neglectful or culture is going down the tubes. I think any of those pat, simplistic answers are just really not helpful.
We
and
are
not describing wait a second. What's going
on. We are teaching to the lowest common denominator. Right?
Well, I certainly think we need a lot of education reform. Yeah, that's one thing I would
and
absolutely
plus
agree with.
Discipline in school has dramatically changed in the last 50 years.
There's a lot of discipline in my classroom.
Of course, that's your anecdote, though, but overall...
But I think statistically, those kind of problems peaked, like, in the early 90s. I don't think it's, you know, crime is down. I mean, not everything is getting worse.
Steve,
I think that's just a confirmation bias.
What about from a purely physiological explanation in terms of brain development? Isn't there still stuff
going on? Oh,
well,
if you're talking about
teenagers.
Teenagers have different functioning brains than adults.
Yeah.
Their brains function differently than adults. The research is steadily...
If at all.
Yeah. So they're not fully matured. You know, the brain does not fully mature until you're in your 20s. So that explains a lot of it. But that's a constant. That's not something that's changing over time, right?
But teenagers are finding out about the world for the first time, particularly if they go to school. They're at school with a new social group and such that they've got to accommodate to. They've got to match in some way. They've got to fit in somewhere or another. They're under huge stress.
Yeah.
And I think that's why they're not that interested that we might expect them or hope them to be.
Yeah, they're more preoccupied with the social aspects growing up.
And, of course, we've pointed out many times that there is an anti-intellectual, sort of anti-authoritarian counterculture in the United States, and, you know, that may be, you know, very intense in the younger age groups. That's particularly why, you know, we and other, you know, members of the skeptical movement are interested in making critical thinking and science cool, you know, and hip. And basically, are you jiggy with that? I'm doing the like, you know, middle-aged white guy street talk thing, you know, like on every sitcom. But you know what I'm talking about, that we want to make people say, yeah, it's actually acceptable and cool to be smart and to like science and to be passionate about that. And I think the audience is filled with people who get it, and we just need more people to get it. Right?
Well, as a teenager, I determined early on that my mother and father weren't terribly smart, and I haven't changed my mind. I'm 81, and I still haven't changed my mind. They weren't very smart.
All right. We've got a couple more.
Hi. I'd like to know, with regards to why some beliefs are persistent and we have trouble with them while others go away. And for example, like homeopathy was a really stupid idea that came out around 1800. and people still take it seriously, and we're still fighting it. Around the same time, an idea called phrenology came out, and we really don't have to go out there and tell people, no, you don't need to go to a doctor who will feel your head and tell you that. And, you know, we also don't have people who are into alchemy and think that they could use goat's blood to turn lead into gold or something. And so, well, not a whole lot of them, at least. Why is it that some of these ideas seem to persist and we go after them and nobody realizes how dumb they are, and others just kind of fade away, and people say, okay, yeah, bumps on your head relating to health and personality, that's stupid, we're not going to deal with that. But
one element in there is the media. And the media will go after a thing like homeopathy because it's medical, apparently, and it cures people, it helps people, and they want to make a case out of it, and then they get a hold of somebody like me, a curmudgeon, a professional curmudgeon of long experience, and they make me look like a fool if they possibly can. Difficult to do, but they do it. And I think that the media is largely to blame for this. Yeah. The media doesn't care about phrenology any longer. If phrenology had just developed recently, maybe they would. But phrenology is sort of in the past.
Yeah, but my hypothesis is, in terms of why do we still have homeopathy and not phrenology, although there are still phrenologists out there, but they are very, very small in number, is that it's just purely historical cultural contingency. It's because phrenology was promoted by neurologists within mainstream medicine. And when the science moved past it and showed that the premises of phrenology were incorrect, then it faded away. How come we don't do bloodletting anymore? Well, it's because bloodletting and the humoral theory of medicine was popular among Western medicine, which then became scientific, and they got rid of it themselves. But homeopathy stood outside of science-based medicine or scientific medicine, became a self-sustaining, immune to evidence and science belief system, and so it persists. So I think there's really nothing fundamentally different between phrenology and, say, chiropractic and homeopathy and acupuncture, except for their cultural history. I think that's the only real difference.
Steve, do you think it's possible, though, that there is an appeal that homeopathy and chiropractic have that maybe the others don't? Like, to me, they seem to have to kind of hit that chord, that magic chord, where there's a vibe about them. You know, they just have
that's
a feel
part of
about
it. I think that's part of
yeah.
it.
Yeah, I mean, you're right, and that's why I said this is a hypothesis of mine, because you can't, I don't know of any evidence to separate out the Darwinian kind of selection of the most successful belief systems surviving and the ones that don't appeal as much, or maybe don't make as much money for their practitioners, or whatever it is. They're not as adaptive, so they don't survive as well. So we actually may be seeing the evolution of these belief systems as the more ones that are more effectively spread, that persist, that are profitable, are the ones that persist. Mm-hmm. But from the examples that I gave, I don't know that I can tell you what's really different between acupuncture and bloodletting, or, in fact, there may not really be any difference at all, or between phrenology and homeopathy, except for their history. That's the only difference that I can think of.
And the one big advantage that homeopathy has to the public is that it's perfectly safe. It's water. Yes. It can't really hurt you, because everyone drinks water, you see, even in the form of wine, for example, which is the way I prefer to ingest it. But nonetheless, it is perfectly safe, and it's also approved by various medical organizations, but the approval is limited to the fact that it won't hurt you. They don't say that it'll help you, but it won't hurt you at least. Oh, we approve it because it won't hurt you.
We're really out of time, so I'm just going to do last question. So I really apologize, but this is the time limits we have.
Aren't we as skeptics open to the possibility that something that's part of a ridiculous methodology can be scientifically proven to actually be true?
Yeah, and we'll give you $1 million if you do it.
Yes.
No, yeah, we're open. I don't think there's anybody in this room that's not open to that possibility. Yes, of course.
Yeah, I mean, skepticism, like science, is not a set of beliefs. Nothing is included automatically or excluded automatically. It's a set of methods.
Right.
So we apply methods.
Some of the talking, though, goes toward that never could possibly be. Like, there's things that are not in Western medicine, and some of them are scientifically proven through statistically
like
valid double bond.
Give me an example, please.
Example, yeah.
Well, I'm not sure if this is right or not, but like green tea.
Mm-hmm. But the green tea, why? Because it has antioxidants in it. Actually, evidence is leaning in the direction that taking, you know, reasonable doses or high doses of antioxidants on a regular basis is probably unhealthy. But it's whatever the evidence says. I mean, if antioxidants were effective, great. I mean, it's purely whatever the evidence points to. There's no a priori inclusion or exclusion of anything. I think that's often what science-based medicine gets tagged at, and you heard John Beneth do it. We rejected it without looking at the evidence, and now we're rejecting it because we don't want to look stupid. Well, no, we're wrong all the time. New data comes in, and we revise our opinions in the face of new data or just new ways of explaining existing data all the time. We're not married to any conclusions. We're married to the process, to the methods. And Western versus Eastern medicine or mainstream versus, those are all false dichotomies meant to divert from the fact that we're about the methods, not the beliefs.
But that doesn't mean also that we're going to start chasing unicorns, you know, indefinitely, you know, just for the sake that someone thinks they saw a unicorn.
Right. Doesn't mean we know nothing. We still have a body of knowledge that, while imperfect and tentative, we are not starting from absolutely square one with every new question. We actually do have knowledge that we can build on.
Thank you. Fail ourselves and we fail everyone in the public if we insist that this can't possibly be so. No, I want you to produce the evidence. We don't say with the James Randi Educational Foundation, for example, we don't say, no, that is not true, any more than we say there is no God. I can't prove there is no God. You say there is, prove it. We offer the alternative. You prove your case. We're not making a case. You make the case, you prove it.
Thank you. Well, Jay, you're going to finish off with a quote for us.
Oh, yeah.
It's up there.
It better be good.
I totally forgot. This is a quote from William W. Channing. Every mind was made for growth, for knowledge, and its nature is sinned against when it is drowned in ignorance. William Channing!
Thank you, everyone, for joining us at NECSS 2010. And I want to say thank you to Michael, Matt, Paige, and Benny, the guys from the New York City Skeptics who did most of the heavy lifting to put this conference together. They did a great job. Thank you, guys.
Hallelujah. Steve Novella and the Skeptics Guide to the Universe.
And thank you, Jamie.
With special guest James Randi. You didn't touch your watch.